And it's
for me, I think.
But talk loud enough so that I can hear you clearly.
Okay.
Today I'm going to talk about 1953 Iran Cup. And also let's begin with Iran.
I'm not very good at it.
teacher. And today we are I'm going to talk about Iran Cup in 1953. And also I chose the Iran versus strategic triangle the topic, but this issue is so deep and long, and I decided to explain today just specific parts. It is Iran Cup. Let's begin with Iran teachers. Iran has rich oil resources and natural gas reserves, and because of this the oil industry was controlled by the US. There is a prime minister of Iran. He was Mohammed Musaddegh, and also it was desiring to nationalize the oil, and also the main reason of the cup is nationalizing of the oil. And in 1951 it was nationalized by the Musaddegh, as I said, but the control of the US didn't change, because the US and USA and Russia always follow the oil resources of Iran. Let's know the Mohammed Musaddegh. Musaddegh was a lawyer and wealthy landowner, but it had gained a reputation with nationalists and diplomats, all liberal Democrats. And reputation means also become famous, like with liberal Democrats and nationalists. By the late 1940s, he identified himself with two main issues. One of them is he was desiring to nationalizing the oil or increase Iran's control over the petroleum, which was controlled by the US. And the other one is public, and which we were ruled the shape of authority. In 1951, Musaddegh nationalized the oil, but Musaddegh and Shah didn't compromise about this issue. And also US and US, USA and Musaddegh, the negotiation done some negotiations, and it's they didn't go well. And in August 1953, an election was made between Shah and Musaddiq. Musaddiq won, but Shah made a coup against Muhammad Musaddiq. But this coup was failed. And also, Shah escaped to the abroad, and again, there's a one more cup happened. It is made by it was made by U.S. and USA. And also in 2003, CIA was declared the cup that the cup was responsible by over the CIA. And Shah was put in the prison, and because of this cup, and also Shah, who escaped to the abroad, came back to Iran, and he became ally to USA. He is Shah. His name, his long name, is Rıza Khan. The other reason of the otherwise, the other issue, there is an other issue in Iran. It is Marxism. Iran was affected by Marxism in 1941. Today party, which related to Marxism, was established, and also Muhammad Musaddiq has a party. Its name is the Turkish meaning Yeni Cephe. And to Muhammad Musaddiq's party and today agreed this issue, this Marxism issue. It was main part of Marxism, as I say. When the 1953 cup occurred, today lost its power, and also Marxism lost its power, but it is didn't end. Marxism didn't end at this point. In 1970s, the rates of Marxism became guerrilla organization. they turn their ideologies from today to a guerrilla organization. Thank you for listening to me.
Good, thank you. And you did very well in terms of communicating without using the, without reading a text. You know, that's very good.
Thank you.
And I hope that you may not learn much about the Middle East in this course, but if you learn to speak in public, that would be really good.
I try to get better or getting better.
No, we all need to be better.
Yes.
But one thing, in at least in the way we express it in English, you should the P in coop is silent. So you should say coop, not
I remember now one thing, the brand of BP Shell oil firm is controlled by US, sorry, UK now, today, still.
Yes. But the other thing to keep in mind, well, two other things. One is that the Cold War was very much part of the context. And the coup was justified more at the time, publicly justified, more at the time as a way of preventing Soviet influence in Iran, displacing American influence. That was really an important part of what was claimed at that time. Subsequent, we learned afterwards that the real point was the oil. That's what really led. Public justification at the time was anti-communism, that the Tudor Party, as you mentioned, was a Marxist party, and that this would global capitalist interests, and in that sense it was a very important event in that period, not so long after World War II, and a indication that the U.S. was not only struggling against the expansion of the Soviet Union, but it was also trying to protect foreign investment in non-Western countries. So capitalism was a very important aspect of these developments in Iran. The other thing that you basically addressed was that this was Mossadegh represented what I was calling the type two nationalism. That is, the nationalism that tries to unify the country against outside intervention and to promote the idea of self-determination, especially in relation to natural resources, the wealth of the country, so an anti-colonial and anti-interventionist. And in that sense, it's an assertion of national sovereignty, keeping foreign investment under control, and making the society benefit from the country's natural resources. The geopolitics of that time were such that Iran was very useful, Iran under the Shah was very useful to the West, because he did things that liberal Western countries couldn't do at that time, which was to supply Israel and South Africa with oil. See, Israel was under great pressure from the Arab countries in that period. And it was a very unpopular thing to do. And South Africa was still an apartheid racist regime. And that was unpopular to send oil to these two countries. And so, having the Shah as the leader in Iran and having him be so subject to this kind of American influence was a big help in a region where the U.S. didn't have very strong support, because Israel at that time particularly was seen as a hostile development, and the U.S. Was very unpopular at that time with the Arab countries, and at the same time needed to have access to the oil reserves of the Gulf countries. See, one of the things in this, I don't know how well you can see this map up there, Iran controls on the southern part of Iran, there's a very narrow strait, the Straits of Hormuz, where much of the exported oil sense, Iran is in a very strategic relationship to oil supply for the rest of the world. And so there's always been a strong emphasis on maintaining control over the orientation of Iran. And so these later developments, you had 1953, where the Western American approach gained control of oil and of the foreign policy of Iran and was very happy with the outcome. It's very happy with the outcome, even though it contradicted, it went against the U.S. supposed support for democracy, because Mossadegh was the overthrown leader, the nationalist leader, who was elected by the Iranian people. And as you pointed out, he was elected over the Shah, who was the preference. So from the point of view of political self-determination, he was the legitimate leader of Iran. And the coup substituted the legitimate leader for this dynasty, this monarchy, and imposed in a way a monarchy upon Iran that could only remain in power by repressing its own population. So it became a very unpopular government that and engaged in very widespread torture, including of middle class students. Students became very radicalized under the Shah and were ready to support this revolutionary movement that emerged after. I mean, there had been other protest movements. There was a very big protest movement in Iran in 1962. And in that movement, Ayatollah Khomeini emerged as a political figure. And he made this famous assertion that if a Iranian car ran over a dog, that person would be in greater trouble than if an American soldier killed an Iranian, because there was a treaty exempting American. There were 45,000 American soldiers in Iran as part 17 years in Iraq, and then Iraq became Saddam Hussein, the dictatorial leader of Iraq, became nervous having this religious leader who was beginning to have a following there in this religious city within Iraq. So he expelled Khomeini from Iraq in 1978, the early part, when the unrest was beginning to occur in Iran. And he, Khomeini was advised that the best place for him to go would be France, to Paris. But the French had a good relationship with the Shah, and so they went, the ambassador, I actually was told this by the French ambassador to Iran, who said that he went to the Shah and said, Khomeini has asked for a visa to come to France. Should we give it to him? And the Shah said, yes, please give it to him. I want him as far away from Iran as possible. See, and this was very pre-modern thinking, because the assumption was that Khomeini was more dangerous the closer he was physically to Iran, whereas in fact, he was much more of a leader of the opposition movement in France than he had been in Iraq, because he had access to the world media. He wasn't known outside of Iran before this. So when he went to Paris, he became a world political figure, and he exerted a lot of influence. He was the leader, and he kept the movement. There was a growing opposition movement in Iran that sought the reform of the country. sure answer for it. But at the time, new students came largely from the urban middle class in the big cities of Iran. And that urban middle class and the people that controlled the Iranian bazaar, you know, like the markets here, were very angry with the Shah for a different reason than what we've talked about. Because the Shah ignored the national capitalist class and relied on international capital.
They were only leftists before they left Iran to study.
A mixture. I think there were some leaders in the U.S. that probably influenced them and may push them further. But they were not. They were definitely not religious. And the only other political perspective at the time was the left. Political perspective. And the most articulate people against the Shah in the U.S. at that time were people on the left. And one of the mistakes the Shah had made, the first mistake of alienating his own national bourgeoisie or national middle class, the merchants and the business people felt they were ignored in favor of foreign capital. And
he couldn't compensate it even if he sent students to the U.S.
Yes, they didn't seem to be grateful for being given this opportunity of free education. And the U.S. at that time was doing anything the Shah wanted to have done. He was such a close ally that they wouldn't question. It wasn't the way it became in recent years, that they would look carefully at the political outlook of the students and others. Now it's very difficult to get visas. Student visas, if you come from this region, as most of you may know, friends and so on.
Lastly, you were saying that a research done in Iran to understand why the protest against Shahbaz Singh were letters.
No, what I'm saying is it wasn't, it didn't have clear identity at the time, the movement. It wasn't, even when Khomeini emerged as the leader, many secular people thought that was just to get rid of the Shah. Khomeini would resume his religious life, and the secular people would run the country. That was it. So what many people, including friends of mine, believed was that the movement would become a return of the Mossadegh kind of leadership, that it would be a new nationalist, in this type two nationalism of keeping the country free from outside intervention. And that it would not be left or right. It would seek to develop the country for the sake of the Iranian people. And that was the belief. I had Iranian friends who gave up their American passport because they wanted to work in this liberal, secular, post-Shah Iran. And then when they discovered that it was really a religiously led movement that gained power and control, then they had to leave. by going back to the religious city of Gome, which is a couple hours from Tehran, filled with madrasas and other things. So nobody has really explained what happened. When Khomeini returned to Iran, he did go back to Gome. And the secular people did run out of government at first, for the first few months. And then in September, about 8 months after the Shah left the country, 9 months, Iranian students seized the American embassy in Tehran and held hostage the diplomats that were in the embassy. That was a big challenge to what would happen in this, and it showed the helplessness of the Americans to, with all that power, to be able to protect their diplomats in this situation. And this changed the nature of revolution in Iran. And it led to the exiling of the early leadership. Mehdi Sadra was the first president, and he was surrounded by communists that were basically from the West, Iranians, but living. They had been living in exile in the West. All these people were eliminated, and the religious nature of the governing process was established and has persisted ever since 1980. And when the American election came, in 1980, on the day that Ronald Reagan was inaugurated as the new American president, the American hostages were released in Tehran, and Iranian assets in banks around the world were freed from being frozen. So that Iran, more than any country in the world, changed from being an unconditional ally of the West and of the US in the period of the Shah to becoming an unconditional enemy. And it became an unconditional enemy because it was very hostile to Israel and to Saudi Arabia, the two special relationships that the U.S. had in the region. And a special relationship means that no matter what that country does, the U.S. will support it. And it overlooks its normal objections, for instance, the violation of human rights in Saudi Arabia, the use of military aggression, and repression against the Palestinians in relation to Israel. So that you have this dramatic change in the outlook of Iran. Not only was it the relationship to Israel and South Africa, but it was also the relationship to political Islam, that it would become a anti-Western elected president. So Iran is a real theocracy. It's a very unusual kind of thing. But it's proved to be the most stable political structure in the region. Had its oppositional movements where people seeking more democracy, more pluralism. It imposes on the public, on the population, prohibition and alcohol prohibition, a lot of Sharia principles. Women have to wear headscarf. And people disobey in quiet ways. For instance, they find ways to get alcohol in their private living, their apartments, they consume alcohol. In other words, it isn't completely subservient. Did win, there were women in there. made two things very clear that are significant in the subsequent development. One was that it didn't matter to him whether a country, a foreign country that had a majority Muslim population was Sunni or Shia. He was non-sectarian in that way. But what it did matter to him whether a country had some kind of elected leader or a monarchy. He felt that a king or a shah was not compatible with Islamic values, and therefore he made very clear, even before he went back to Iran, that Saudi Arabia was as illegitimate as the Shah's government in Iran. So the tension that emerged between Iran and Saudi Arabia should have come as no surprise, because both looked upon the Saudi Arabia turned out to be critical. Saudi Arabia rested its opposition to the government in Iran on sectarian grounds. That it, as the Sunni state adhering to Wahhabism, was the guardian of the sacred Muslim sites, Mecca and Medina, and the only other one was Jerusalem and Medina, so that it had the authority, that its mode of Islamic practice should be the accepted one. So it regarded the Iranian revolution as unacceptable, illegitimate. It was more comfortable with the Shah, a fellow monarch, than it was with what you would have thought was more compatible, that is, an Islamic So that this tension between royalism or dynastic rule
Jaren.
C-E-R-E-N.
Jaren.
C-E-R-E-N.
She's not the issues. Your PhD course. As I said, I am a student driver. We will be ready upstairs.
Okay.
So you will go back to your apartment.
Yes.
Okay. Have a
fine
time.
Thanks.
Have
a nice
weekend.
Thank you. The only other two things that I wanted to talk a little bit about was the effort to prevent Iran from acquiring nuclear weapons, which was a somewhat controversial initiative, because after all, Israel possesses nuclear weapons. Why shouldn't other countries have an equal right to acquire it? Raises this question I discussed a little bit last time about this fundamental inequality between the countries that can have those weapons and those that are denied the right to acquire them. And that was, as I said, was originally based on this bargain in the international agreement that the non-nuclear states would agree not to acquire nuclear weapons, but the nuclear states would agree in good faith to try to get rid of it. So what you have is the unequal enforcement of that treaty. So you make the under threat of war, you enforce the treaty against the non-nuclear states, and you ignore the other half of the bargain, whereby the nuclear weapons states agree to get rid of their weapons. See, that's it's a very illuminating example of what I've been calling geopolitics, where some few states can act independently of law or equality, and the rest are subject to a standards of restraint that will be imposed if it isn't obeyed. discovery, the puzzle was challenged. The puzzle of how you maintain this kind of unequal arrangement in relation to Iran. And Iran had a logical security reason to acquire nuclear weapons because it was constantly under threat from stronger countries. So by the logic of sovereignty, the acquisition of nuclear weapons made a lot of sense. But from the point of view of geopolitics, regional and global, it was unacceptable. You see, that's the underlying tension. It was also dangerous from a Western point of view because Iran is a country of 82 million. It's four times the population of Syria and three times the population of Yemen. So it would not be a small undertaking to oppose them. They also have developed important non-nuclear military capabilities, including fairly long-range missiles that could be fired in the direction of Israel. They also have allies in the region, Hezbollah in Lebanon, and the Palestinian Authority in Gaza, and the Houthis in Yemen. So there was some reason to think that from a Western point of view, a compromise would be desirable. And from an Iranian point of view, also, despite the fact that they had this security argument, and from a certain point of view, they had as much a right as anyone else to acquire these weapons, they were under severe economic pressure from sanctions and from a kind of diplomatic isolation. So they would have some immediate benefits for their population if they could get out of this kind of trap, in a way, where they were being accused. They always denied that their objective was nuclear weapons, including the Supreme Leader, kept insisting that Iran would never develop these weapons. But this was disbelieved by Israel and to some extent by the U.S. So during the presidency of Obama, the American president who preceded Trump, there was a strong effort to achieve some kind of compromise. And by hard negotiations, they reached an agreement that was informally known as 5+1, that is the five members of the Security Council, five permanent members, plus Germany. And it was seen as a breakthrough because Iran agreed not to allow its nuclear program to move imprison them. He says, this is a horrible agreement. It doesn't guarantee that Iran will become in some future non-nuclear weapons state. We don't accept this agreement. We put maximum pressure on Iran, not only to give up its nuclear program, but not to mess around in the region by supporting Palestinians in Gaza or Hezbollah in Lebanon, and causing trouble in Iraq. So Trump made a series of demands that went beyond the nuclear issue. And this led Iran and its leadership to say, we will put our own form of maximum pressure. And they sank some Western tankers. And most dramatically, they are at least accused to have attacked the Saudi oil facilities in the middle of September. The Houthis in Yemen claimed that the attack was under their authority, but most observers think that they would not have acted without Iranian support and guidance. And this attack affected 50% of Saudi Arabia's capacity to export oil. So it was a really major attack. And what was most dramatic about it was first to expose the vulnerability of Saudi Arabia to an attack of this kind, but also the failure to respond showed a reluctance to move this confrontation into a war phase, war stage. So it seems to have had the effect of encouraging countries that had been very aggressive in their relationship to Iran to back away.
Today, in the world, USA and Iran look like enemies.
Yes.
But do you think are they agree with each other secretly?
You mean Saudi Arabia and Iran?
Agree. USA and Iran agree to each other secretly. Do you think is this situation possible? I think there is something that not exposed between USA and Iran. If my question is not related this lesson or issue, now I can ask you again after the lesson.
No, it's relevant, very relevant, though because it asks about secret negotiations or secret understanding, the secret is sufficiently well kept that I can't answer, I can't tell you whether that's happening or not. It would not be impossible. And it is part of diplomacy. they don't want to impose sanctions and other punitive and dangerous burdens on Iran. So it's a moment where things could get better or worse. It's very hard to tell. And it should be getting better. I mean, it's in the interest of really of all the actors to avoid a war and to avoid this kind of tension and dangerous incidents. But whether they act rationally and in a effective way is almost impossible to tell. And from the perspective, looking at it from the perspective of the U.S., we have never had a leader as irrational as Trump. That reason as dangerous to what he can do, surprisingly good things at times, but also surprisingly provocative and dangerous things at other times. And that's not the kind of leadership that is good for this complex, uncertain kind of world. But these things are very important, and I think we can leave Iran with this understanding that it would be very helpful to restore this nuclear agreement. Turkey tried as early as 2010 to find a way to produce an agreement with Iran that was satisfactory to the outside world. And it was during the period when Davutoglu was the foreign minister here, was very eager to achieve this kind of accommodation. Maybe if Trump was not re-elected in 2020 in the U.S., a Democratic leader, Democratic Party leader, would be much more prepared to restore the Obama approach. And if that happened, one could see a new stability, particularly if the ending, if the Syrian situation is converted into a kind of situation of peace, or some kind of end of the civil war. The other development is this sense that the sectarian tensions have proved to be an unsuccessful way for Saudi Arabia to gain control over the region. And we'll talk next time about the Gulf crisis. Sunni leadership in Iran. All these developments gave Iran much more influence in Iraq than it had previously during the period of Saddam Hussein's leadership there. But in recent weeks, these Iraqi protest movements have, like Lebanon, have emphasized nationalist unity, overcoming sectarianism, and suggesting that Iran's influence in Iraq is not a healthy thing for the country. And the religious leader in Iraq, a Shiite, Ayatollah Sistani, has said very clearly that he would like a more pluralist Iraq that has this type 2 nationalism that is unified, unity of the people, and not a transnational connection between Shia majority countries. So what has happened in this recent period of the last, let's say, 20 years, is the rise of sectarianism, especially after the American occupation of Iraq in 2003, and the more aggressive Saudi foreign policy. And now, the pushback against sectarianism, which is occurring in a number of countries. This new political wave of support for nationalism, that's really something unexpected, and maybe combined with this Russian entry into the politics of the region, will bring a new stability.